morning, everyone. Let's take our white folders this morning and turn to number 37, and then we'll sing number 31, 1, 3, and 4 of that one as well as we get gathered here into worship. Number 37. Now number 31 there, and we'll sing 1, 3, and 4.
Thank you.
Well, welcome everyone. I'm glad you safely made it here this morning, and we're ready to come and to serve and to worship our God here at Christ the King PCA. Let's be called with these words from Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. God is our refuge and strength. Let's bow before him and ask his blessing upon this worship this morning. Indeed, O Lord our God, we've come to worship and to serve you, to look upward and to look inward at our own hearts, to be measured by your word and encouraged by your Holy Spirit. May the joy of this moment overtake us, Lord, as we focus upon you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand together and respond from the scriptures to God's invitation to worship? You have multiplied, O Lord my God, your wondrous deeds and your thoughts toward us. None can compare with you.
I will proclaim and tell of them, yet they are more than many told.
God says to you, his people, grace and mercy and peace be upon you from Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's continue our praises to God this morning by turning to number 301 in our Blue Psalters, 301. Hallelujah, praise Jehovah, number 301. Sit down there, beloved. We want to turn, as we've been doing in our service of confession for a few weeks now, back to the prophet Isaiah again, as he pronounces the woes on his generation, because within those woes are those truths that apply to our generation as well. And we've been looking at them one by one. This morning I would like to point to you to verse 21. Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and shrewd in their own sight. Does that mean God wants uneducated, stupid people in the world? No, it doesn't say woe to those who are wise. It doesn't say woe to those who are shrewd, but woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and shrewd in their own sight. What does God tell us at the beginning of the Proverbs? He says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. So it's not a question of whether God wants us to be wise. He wants us to be wise in His way. And He wants us to funnel everything that we think through the Scriptures, through His words, so that we come to the correct conclusions about our lives. And so He warns us, you know. And we live in a society, and it's very apt to us today, too, because we live in the postmodern age where everybody thinks they can create truth from themselves, wise in their own eyes. Whatever, you can have your own truth, I'll have my own truth, and the third guy over there, he'll have his own truth, too. And everybody will be right. That's exactly the kind of thing that Isaiah was talking about, isn't it? See? Wisdom in your own eyes is doomed to fail, because our own eyes are always clouded by the sins of the world and the sins of our own heart. So let's take this to our thoughts this morning as we have a time of personal confession, and then I will close at the end. Shall we pray? Lord our God, we eschew the wisdom of man, the wisdom of our world, which goes astray from you. We accept only what comes to us as established by your word, full of your wisdom. In fact, you even personify your wisdom as walking through the streets, crying out at every corner. May we be those who listen to that. Forgive us when we don't. Forgive us when we go astray from your most holy words and commandments. Forgive us when we think that our ways are better than your ways. Forgive us when we treasure something above you. And do that for the sake of Jesus. For he was the Word come down. And as we focus upon him today, Lord, let us hear his voice. And as he speaks then truth to us, that we may be wise in your eyes and not wise in our own eyes. We will be thankful for that. In his blessed name we pray. Amen. Let's turn and sing a hymn of confession as well this morning. Number 95, we'll remain seated in our blue psalters, number 95, and may this be your prayer this morning as we sing it.
Thank you.
Also would like to share with you this morning from 1 Peter chapter 5. You know, Isaiah says, woe to those who are wise in their own eyes. Listen to what Peter says to us in chapter 5 and verse 6. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the almighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you. See, what is the Christian response to the woe of Isaiah? Yes, I'm duly humbled, Lord. I'm humbled in your sight. Just as we sang from the Psalm there, 32, about the broken heart before God. That's the signal of the Holy Spirit within us, that we have been born again, that we have been redeemed, that our hearts are broken about sin and about pride and about wisdom in our own eyes. So receive that as God's pardon to you. If you're humbled before the Lord Jesus Christ, then indeed your sins have been forgiven for his sake. We're going to turn to prayer this morning. We want to, you always have your sheet in your bulletin for many good things to pray about during the week and with your families. But I also want to add to that, if you didn't hear, Bev's friend Patty McCracken was in a really severe car accident, broken hip, broken elbow, fractured pelvis, a multitude of problems there. So, and in fact, she's scheduled for some more surgeries this morning, so let's remember her. She is a believing woman. Bev's known her since she was a child, and she walks in faith, so let's pray for the Lord's strength on her behalf this morning, as among other things. Would you gather to the throne of grace? We enter in based upon the grace of Jesus, O Lord our God, this morning. We would not be able to lift up our heads, lift up our hearts, even gaze towards the eternal kingdom, were it not for the fact that Jesus has went before us, that our mediator is now there in heaven advocating for us, that the Holy Spirit has come into us and prays with us, even in those times when all we can do is sigh and groan and don't know exactly what words to bring before you. You are ministering to us and for us before the throne. We give you thanks, O our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that in the perfections of your triune nature, you have reached out to us and brought us into fellowship with you. That fellowship which you have had from eternity within yourself. And you have told us we are your children and therefore come to the Father in heaven. For when we ask, he will not give us a stone for bread or a snake for fish, but indeed he will meet all of our needs. And so we come, Lord, for we are a needy people. We have our own daily needs and struggles. We pray for this sister in the Lord here, Patty, who was brought into a severe trial by you, Lord, in your providence. We accept it from you. We don't know why you do these things always, Lord, but you are our sovereign King and Lord, and you bring what you see is for our own good and for the best of your church as well into the lives of your people. And sometimes, Lord, that is suffering, pain, and difficulty. But yet you encourage us also to pray for healing, for strengthening, and for help as well. And so we lift Patty up to you this morning, and may your Holy Spirit minister to her heart and lives. May the people of God gather around her in this time of struggle and trouble as well. We thank you for our brothers and sisters across the PCA and for the faithfulness of your church. And we ask, Lord, that it would be preserved, that it would grow, that these church plants that we have would thrive, that more church plants which are in the plans would come to fruition, so that the righteousness of God may be seen in the gathering of his people across this land and throughout the world. We know it is, Lord, to some degree, everywhere in this world, and yet we desire it to prosper more and more. We think of countries like India, which have set their hearts against you, of the Middle East, by and large, Lord, and it seems like these are impenetrable from a human perspective, but they are not, Lord. They belong to you. All the peoples of the earth are yours, and so we ask that you would bring the gospel strongly into these places of darkness, and that it would shine brightly in our own land as well, that it would be brought to bear in commerce and in the schools and in government, in all of these places, Lord, where those in the past have tried to shut it out, it will not be silenced, Lord. And you and your kingdom and your church will grow and grow to fill the earth. We look forward to that day. May we be faithful in our part in Barry County. May we be faithful in our families as we read the scriptures, as we pray, as we press home this covenantal good news of the gospel to our children and to our grandchildren and great-grandchildren. And may when we die someday, Lord, each one of us be able to look back and say that we have fought the good fight. We have kept the faith. We had finished the course. We want to do that as your people. We pray this morning also, Lord, that you would bless particularly our work in Armenia of translating the scriptures, a little bump in the road there about copyrights and things, Lord. Would you smooth the way and help that to be finished and into a good result as well, so that this new translation may come out next year and begin to speak more clearly to the people of that land as well. These and many other things, Lord, we bring to you. For you are a God who delights to hear from your people. You are a God who delights to give us those things that we pray, which are according to your will. And in fact, we know you will do that. So we give you thanks for that. Blessings to your name, Lord. We worship before you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us sing again before we come to the Word of God this morning. In the preaching of the Word, let's turn to number 314. Come thou fount of every blessing. 314, let's stand together and sing that. Thank you. Amen. You may be seated. Just learned something new just while I was singing that song. The author of that is Asahel Nettleton. Anybody know who he was? He was a great revivalist preacher, Calvinist, who stirred the people of God in his day. I think Pat has a biography about him back there in the back. Do you, Pat? He does. He's shaking his head. So if interests you who wrote that hymn, Asahel Nettleton, you can get Pat's biography back there, as well as many other good books. Well, let's turn to the Word this morning. Take your Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 15. Matthew chapter 15. We're going to read this morning a text of Scripture, which some people would look at and say, it's outrageous. How can Jesus talk like that? And we'll see what he says there. In chapter 15, beginning with verse 21, this is God's word. And Jesus went away from there and withdrew to the district of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and was crying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is severely oppressed by demons." But he did not answer her a word. And his disciples came and begged him, saying, "Send her away, for she is crying out after us." And he answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." And he answered, "It is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "O woman, great is your faith. Be it done for you as you desire." And her daughter was healed instantly. Shall we pray? Lord, manifest yourself and your ways in our lives as we read the Scriptures, as we study them together, as we hear them preached. For through them, the voice of the Almighty God speaks today in the 21st century. So give us careful attention, Lord. Give us hearts that are open to what you are going to say, that they may respond back to you in an appropriate way. In Jesus' name, amen. This is not exactly the picture of Jesus that we generally think about. Here this woman comes to him, and for the first part of the text here, he says nothing. He's ignoring her. Now, we know he's ignoring her because she is shouting, and the Greek word here is crying out very loud. She's not saying, "Hey, can you help me?" She's saying, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me." And that didn't bring a result, so she kept shouting in, "Help me, save me, work for me, my daughter's dying." You get the idea. And they're in this house somewhere there, and she's not stopping. And Jesus is saying nothing to her. And then when he does speak to her, he says, "I'm sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. You're not of the house of Israel." We know that, of course, because the text tells us that she was a Canaanite. Now, the Canaanites were the worst of the worst, weren't they? They were the people in the Old Testament that God said, "These people, I'm going to give them 400 years because they're so full of iniquity, I'm still going to give them 400 years. That's a merciful statement right there. But after that, I want you to kill them all. Every one, last one of them, down to the men, the women, and the children, you're to as God's people, you're to destroy them because they've become so wicked. Well, we know they didn't entirely destroy all the Canaanites, and they did survive. And here, this will be 1,000 years later, there's still a Canaanite here and there in the world, and this woman belonged to that group of people. But it gives us a little jolt, doesn't it? Because it seems like that Jesus doesn't care. I mean, he's quiet. I mean, he's silent. And then when he does speak to her, he gives her an answer which we would not typically think is the gospel answer, you know, like he's done to many other people, you know, inviting them. How do we understand that then? Well, there's a couple of things I think we need to say about that to be able to understand this. One, let's get it in the context. The context of Matthew here is that he's proclaiming Jesus as the Messiah, the King of the Jews, and the Savior who's come down to fulfill all the promises that were made to Abraham. So I think there's a time thing. We have to understand that everything on earth flows out of and through time, okay? And God has a specific plan, and he's working it through time. And he doesn't deviate from that. And his plan from the Old Testament was to call a people out to himself, and he did that in Abraham, and he said, through you, Abraham, through my covenant promise with you, all of the nations will be blessed, but it comes through your line. And then he says the same thing to David, doesn't he? That I'm going to bring one from your house, and he's going to rule forever. And so God's plan was to separate this people and have them be faithful to him, and then the Messiah was coming out of their midst to the benefit of the whole world. But that had to work its way through the time clock, you might say. And at this point that Jesus is speaking, he's not going to deviate from God's plan, which was to bring the covenantal Messiah into the midst of the Jews and first offer them salvation in their Messiah. And then later, of course, we find out from the apostles, it is open to the whole world at that point. But first it had to come to this covenantal people, disobedient that they may have been. And so Jesus has made a move here. You know, he's under some pressure. They're trying to make him king by force. They want just to get the bread from him. They want the welfare payments from the Messiah, or however you want to describe it. And Herod is hearing about him. He kills John, and he would like to get his hands on Jesus too. So they withdraw up into a Gentile area. Tyre and Sidon was north, in the area of Lebanon, and it was definitely no longer a Jewish area. And they come into this house, and he probably is doing this to find the escape and have some time with his disciples. But as in other places, somebody hears about it, and this woman hears about it and comes to plead for her demon-possessed daughter. And I think that's the way to understand Jesus' statement there, that though he's went to a Gentile land, he is not going to change the plan of God, which was to come through the covenantal line in the Jewish people and then go out to the world. But it posed a dilemma for this woman, didn't it? Because she's not of the, I mean, she's a Canaanite. You can't get farther in sort of a biblical thinking from being Jewish to being a Canaanite. And yet she's in desperate need, isn't she? And there's nowhere else to go. Obviously, her Canaanite gods have not helped her. whatever she has done to try and free her daughter from her demon possession among her own people has been a failure. And so she comes to Jesus. So that statement is a historical statement. It's not to be understood as a statement that Jesus doesn't care about the Gentiles. He's already healed the Roman soldier's servant. So it's not that he does not have any dealings with the Gentiles, but he's following the plan of God. And so that's the first thing that we need to understand from this text here. But I think the second and the greatest thing that we need to glean out of this text is what comes at the very last verse that I read. O woman, great is your faith. Now, Jesus doesn't use that commendation to very many people. In fact, one of the other times he uses it was also to a Gentile, to the centurion. But what was it then, and I think this is what we want to pull out of this text, what was so great about this woman's faith? What made her have a mega faith? And that's the Greek word there, actually the same word we get the word mega from in the English language. She has this great faith. Well, what is the content of that faith there that made her so special that Jesus said, woman, great is your faith? Well, I think there's five things, and this is what I want us to look at in this text this morning. First of all, her faith was directed to the right place, to the correct object. Secondly, her faith was a repentant faith. Thirdly, her faith was a reverent faith. Fourthly, it was a persistent faith. I know there's a lot of adjectives here. And fifthly, it was a humble faith. And I would submit to you, beloved, that's the kind of faith you need this morning as well. That one of the reasons that Jesus says, great is your faith to this Canaanite woman, was that she got it. She knew God had produced in her heart a real faith. The Bible talks about all kinds of faith, doesn't it? James talks about dead faith. There's other instances where it talks about weak faith or little faith. And so there's various adjectives given to faith in the scriptures. And here we have great faith. Isn't that the kind of faith you want, beloved? Isn't that the kind of faith that you want to have? And sometimes I think in today's society, when we think of someone having great faith, We think of great Christians doing great things, you know. Maybe someone gets healed or someone undertakes a great project and it costs a lot of money and they get it done, and we say they've had great faith. Well, those are instances of faith, certainly. But the way Jesus is commending this woman, she has not done anything in that sense. It's all what has taken place in her heart. That's where the greatest faith is. The great faith is in your heart. Well, how do we see that? Well, first of all, we see that it's directed to the correct object there. And behold, a Canaanite woman from the region came out and was crying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David." She had went away from the Canaanite gods. She had went away from her doctors and whoever was trying to help her. And she was looking at Jesus. And that's where great faith begins. It has to have its object as the Lord Jesus Christ. And the two terms there, the Lord is a term of deity, and also Son of David is a term of his messiahship. Throughout the scriptures there, the New Testament, whenever you're hearing this Son of David, Son of David. Remember when Jesus comes down on the later on in his life, he's coming down off the mountain into Jerusalem, and the little kids are waving the branches, and they're singing their songs, and they're laying their coats on the ground. And what are they saying? Hosanna, Son of David. This is the title of the king. And though she comes from a foreign nation and a foreign religion, God has captured her heart in such a way that she realizes there is only one who can help, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, God, King of Israel there. So where does great faith come from? Well, it does not even begin until you begin to look at the Lord Jesus Christ. There's no faith in faith. There's no faith in churches or all the things that people put their faith in and think that they've accomplished something. Trust, beloved, has to come in our looking at the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the first part of a great faith. Secondly, it's repentant. I mean, it's not saying it explicitly in the text, but obviously there were plenty of people she could have went to up in Tyre and Sidon. They had their own gods and their own ways, but she doesn't go to them. She turns away from them. And in fact, that's not the only indication of her repentance, from her turning away from her own society and idolatry, but also she accepts the Lord's judgment about her. I mean, this is a tough passage. I mean, it's got some harsh words in it. He just basically calls her a dog, doesn't he? Later on there, it says, it's not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs. Now, some people make much of the fact that there are two words for dogs in the Greek language. One for those rabid street dogs that were all across the Middle East at that time. And then for puppies, this is the word for puppies. You know, it's not your rabid street dog. However, it's still a dog. You know, and he's saying, you're a dog in this world. And only a repentant heart will accept that from God. You call someone a sinner today, you call them a wretch, an evil person, a wicked one, one who has gone astray, and they're all offended. Not this woman. She had great faith. And part of that faith was repentance. Part of that repentance is to accept God's pronouncement concerning you as a sinner in this world. See, everybody wants to think they're okay. Nobody wants to be called a dog. But it wasn't meanness. This is a kind of actually a reality statement. This is humanity, beloved, without God. I don't care if he uses the word puppies or whether he uses the word for the ravenous street dogs. Both and all would apply to anyone who is outside of the Lord Jesus, who's not seeking in trust to follow him. But she does, see. You can tell by her comment back to him that she's not disputing the fact that she's the little dog there under the table. So she has the correct object for her faith. She has the right attitude, repentance. And we see that also even thirdly in the text, because she says, have mercy on me. You don't need mercy unless you need mercy. You don't need mercy unless you're in desperate straits. And she realizes that, you see. And that is a component of true faith. You remember the story of the two guys that went up to the temple to pray. And the one was a hypocrite. And he said, I'm glad I'm not like those other people. He didn't use the word dogs, but it was in his mind, I'm sure. I'm glad I'm not like those dogs. And the other guy, who stood at the back and wouldn't lift up his eyes to heaven, said, have mercy on me. And what does Jesus say about that man? He's the one who went home justified. He's the one who went home right with God because he was repentant concerning his life. And we see that in this lady's life. Also, we see that she's reverent. She calls him Master. She calls him Lord. And this is something that's lost out of our society too today. Very largely, when people think about God at all, they think about him as a giant vending machine. He's there to serve me. He ought to be glad. He ought to be glad that I'll take time for him. He ought to be glad that I'll go to church sometimes. He ought to be glad that I would put a dollar in an offering plate. It's this cavalier approach to the living God. Not this lady. She's reverent. She says, Master. She says, Lord. It's kind of tied together with the last one there, the humility that we see in this woman. She falls down before him. It's actually the word in verse 25 is probably not as accurate as it could be. It's the word for worship. And its roots in the Greek and the Hebrew language is to fall on your face. No strength left in you. No pride left in you. You're falling on your face before the living God. That's mega faith. That's the kind of faith that you have. It's not like, well, okay, you know, give me whatever you want, Jesus. I think I have some time for you. This is someone who's encountering the living God. And they realize there's only one reaction to encountering the living God. That is to fall down in humility before him. Is that where your heart is here? Beloved, this morning, when you think of the living God, are you kind of standing there on your own two feet? Some people are standing on their own two feet saying, I don't need him at all. They obviously have no mega faith. They have no faith at all. And they're in danger. And then there are others say, well, you know, I'll kind of give in to him a little bit. But this lady with great faith falls before the living God on her face. And that's what makes her faith great. Reverence and humility. And then I think the last thing that we see about her too is that she has a persistent faith. I mean, if anything would have knobbed you off and made you angry and put you off, how about being called a dog? First of all, ignored entirely, called a dog, told that you don't fit, that you're not right. Most people would be leaving in a huff, saying, if that's who God is, I don't want him. You've known people like that. The slightest offense, the slightest thing that God says that doesn't connect with him, that doesn't fit with their their image of who he is or who they want him to be, and they're out the door. And here's a woman who had every reason to leave that day, except that her heart was captured by faith already. The God of heaven had already begun his work in her and done his work, and she wasn't leaving. She wasn't leaving. She kept crying out. She comes falling down. And then Jesus has this conversation with her it's not right to take the bread. See, he's thinking about this time thing, this development of salvation. Don't take the bread. Don't take that what belongs to the covenant people and throw it to the Canaanite Gentile dog. Martin Luther says, but she catches him in his words. Nobody catches Jesus in his words very often in the scriptures, are there? But she does. She says, yes, but even, she's acknowledging that she's a dog. She just says, but even the dogs catch that little crumb that falls from the master's table. Children will be all right. They're still going to get their bread, but can you give me a crumb? That's great faith, beloved. She realized all I need is a crumb of the living God. That would suffice me. That would be everything to me. And as Luther said, she caught him in his words, and Jesus, who was, I believe, the whole time going to rescue and help this woman, because Jesus being God, of course, saw her faith. And he, does he throw her a crumb? More than that, beloved. More than that, because he says to her at the end, O woman, great is your faith, be it done to you as you desire. She got the daughter healed of her demon possession. She found faith in the living God. You'll see this woman, although she's not named here. We'll have to ask around in heaven to find the exact woman somewhere. But the persistence of her faith held on. And that's what true faith is. That's what great faith is then. And frankly, if you look at that list, those things that are described, you, each one of you can have that kind of faith this morning. Directed towards Jesus, repentant, reverent, humble, persistent. That's mega faith. That's what we all can have this morning. Shall we pray? Lord, thank you for the lessons from your word, the encouragement, the strength of that, and for your great mercies. For now you have spread the bread of life to the entire world. It's come down to us who are Americans, English speakers. It's come all over the world now, and you invite all into your kingdom, all to have the faith of the Canaanite woman. May it rise up in our hearts in exactly the same way. Amen. Let's sing before we come to the Lord's table then now this morning. Number 61 in our white folders there. We'll find that and stand together and sing that.
Thank you.
You may be seated. It's a little bit of an anomaly, that whole situation, see, because no longer would we have to say that anymore. Well, you don't belong to the children of Israel. Because now, since the death, when Jesus finished that work, and resurrection of Jesus, one of the first things he says to his apostles, or one of the last things, but the first things after his resurrection is, take this gospel to every creature now. Bring it to the whole world. Start in Jerusalem and Judea and go to Samaria and then go out to the utter, go to Iria and Jaya and Manaho and even those little countries of the world, everywhere, bring this gospel. And when you do, and you establish the disciples and you gather them and teach them, you'll present to them the Lord's Supper. Everywhere that you go, you'll show the invitation of Jesus. And that's what it is as well, you know. Because every time you come to the Lord's Supper, it's not only a strengthening for you as a person, as a believer, but it's also a proclamation of what this Jesus has done for the entire world. His blood was poured out. His body was broken for people in the farther stretches and places, for all of those Canaanites of the world. So let's come to his table. Lord, we rejoice in the fullness and the wideness of the gospel now in this age in which we live. And we're delighted to be reminded of it, to fellowship in it every week as we come to your table. And so bless your people, not only with strengthening power as they meet this meal with faith, but also that it will be serving to strengthen the proclamation of this good news everywhere. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, it's interesting too, and it's, as long as we're kind of on this particular passage here, you know, Jesus could have just left the Passover as it was, but he doesn't, you see. He institutes something new, which indicates right there, you see, now it's going to go above and beyond and out through to the entire world, the Lord's Supper. It's not an exact replica of that Jewish feast in the Old Testament. It's something entirely new with the true Passover lamb, the Lord Jesus Christ, at the heart of it all. And to do that, he said to his disciples, look, when you go, take bread. And after you've given thanks, break it and hand it out and remind people, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, the cup. He says, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. As often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim my death until I come again. So come together, receive the bread, beloved, receive the wine, and then we'll partake together. Thank you. Take the bread, beloved, eat it. Remember and believe that Jesus' body was broken for you. Now take the cup, drink from it, and remember that Jesus' blood is sufficient. His precious blood was poured out to wash away all your sins. Let's pray that prayer that Jesus taught his disciples.
Our Father, who art in heaven. Deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let's rise and sing then one more song of praise to our God, 59 in the white folders there, and we'll ask then Reverend Lorenz to come and give us God's blessing at the end of that. Number 59.
Open your hearts wide to receive his benediction. And now may the Father in heaven, out of his glorious riches, strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. Yes, so that Christ himself may live in your hearts through faith. May this grace, mercy, and peace be yours in abundance today, tomorrow, and forevermore. Amen.